Hello and welcome to ATX TV Festival Season 10. I know we're about halfway through this shindig and I have to keep saying it. Season 10? I can't quite wrap my head around it. A decade. It just seems impossible for a number of reasons. We'll get into that later, probably over margaritas and queso. I am Caitlin McFarland, one of your co-hosts and co-founders of the festival, and could not be more proud to partner with the CW this year for an exclusive conversation about The Republic of Sarah, which premiered this week. And our badge holders have the opportunity, if you haven't already, to watch the first two episodes. This show really does give me all the feels. I'm a child of the 90s, and while this show is not set in the 90s, it does have some old school vibes to it, and I've been trying to figure out why, so I hope this panel helps me. But ultimately, it's just full of incredibly unique characters in an even more unique scenario, starting their own nation, totally normal. I hope you all fall in love with them as much as we did, from the actors that embody them to the director that brought it to the screen and the creator showrunner who, as we know, touches it all. So let's kick this off with your moderator, Emily Aslanian from TV Guide Magazine.
Hi. Hey. I'm so excited to be here. Thank you so much. I'm going to start introducing our cast members for The Republic of Sarah. Let's start off with Sarah herself, Stella Baker.
Hi.
Hi. Next, we've got Danny Cooper, who plays Sarah's brother, Luke Mitchell.
Hi.
Next, we've got Hope Lauren. She plays Corinne Dearborn.
Hi.
And Mia Holloway, who plays AJ Johnson. Last on our cast, we've got Ian Duff, who plays Grover Sims.
Hey.
And we've got creator Jeffrey Paul King. And last, but very much not least, we have Kat Candler, director.
Hey.
Awesome. Thank you guys so much. It's great to see all your faces, even if it's virtual. So The Republic of Sarah, it's this awesome show that hopefully people have seen already, but if they haven't seen, this will clear up all their questions. Follows high school history teacher Sarah Cooper, played by Stella, who's mobilized to turn her hometown of Greylock into this independent sovereign. Because this crazy bloodthirsty corporation called Leiden Industries shows up and starts to tear up her town because they want to dig for this valuable mineral that is all underneath them. So Sarah mobilizes and she starts to do some amazing things in her community. Jeffrey, I just want to start with you. This show is just so different. I feel like there's nothing else on the CW like this. There's nothing else on TV like this in general. How did this concept come about?
Boy, what a sales pitch. We should hire you. Thank you. I mean, the concept, it's something that had been percolating in my head for a long time. I worked for a CBS show called Elementary for 7 seasons. And when I finished there, CBS called and said, hey, you know, you've done great work with the studio. What do you want to do? You know, what's in your head? And when I dumped my brain out onto the table, this notion had been sort of was inside of it. You know, I've always been fascinated by maps and cartography and sort of nation building. My undergraduate degree is in cultural geography and cartography, Dork with a capital D. And so I was always sort of fascinated by, like, how do you build a country? And less so the big questions, like, how do you do it with capital letters, and more the small questions? Like, how do you, like, if you're a new country, how do you get into the Olympics? Like, whose number do you call to do that? You know, like, how do you start your own money, and who designs it, and how do you get the paper to design it? All the sort of myriad questions that come with building a nation on a smaller scale. So the idea that felt like it was an idea that had legs. You could do a lot of episodes about those crazy questions, some of which are very dramatic and intense, like how do you do an education system or a healthcare system? And some of which are just a lot of fun, like what's on your flag and how do you go to the World Cup? You know, does the varsity soccer team go to the World Cup? So that's sort of the where the premise was built and tried to ground it in reality. You know, there's a lot of like real kind of weird geographic anomalies around the world that I've researched and studied in building this. And then obviously you want to dump a bunch of really compelling characters into that premise. And so it just was sort of born of like, what points of view would I like to see in that blender? You know, how do we get a cast that has love for each other, but also got lots of conflict and lots of drama? And I think we ended up doing that, and then obviously got amazing actors to fill those parts. So it was all sort of born of, like I said, my kind of love for maps and cartography ultimately.
That's awesome. I have to ask, since you kind of brought this up, do we get to see a Greylock flag? Is that a thing?
So the Greylock's flag is, at some point you will, I will say, you do get to see Greylock's money, the currency, the design of the currency is early, and there's a lot of fun to be had about like who's on it, what's on it, what it looks like, the size of certain things on that currency. I'll leave it at that. You get to see, the currency is something that gets answered pretty early.
That's very cool. It's almost like elements that you would see in a world building fantasy drama in this very like down to earth, realistic, I mean, maybe not that realistic, but like could happen in real life kind of thing, which is crazy.
Yeah, it's funny, like sci-fi is interesting. Maybe we should be calling it poly sci-fi. You know, it is sort of like it's based in the realistic world of poly sci. I mean, this sort of stuff does kind of weirdly happen. And you think, you know, if you're older than like 7 years old, there's a new country on the map in your lifetime in South Sudan. You know, this is stuff happens. The UN did not just appear in 1910. You know, new countries are born and all the time. So, and I think to your point about realistic, you know, I think the show is realistic. It's not really, we're taking liberties and we still want to make a fun drama and keep things moving. But there's a lot of realism in the show. A lot of it is based on true, you know, a lot of research and stuff that has happened in the real world.
Awesome. Now, I wanted to start about the pilot because people may or may not have seen it by the time they come to this, and pilots can get really tricky. There's a lot of information for a show like this and an amazingly huge cast of characters that we get to meet. Kat, I was wondering, what were some of the biggest challenges bringing this from page to screen?
Oh my gosh, wow. Well, I'll start with, I was just super excited about this project because on the page I read this punk rock, badass, like wickedly smart character, this female character that was just a total badass, but also like completely messy and flawed and like just delicious in that way. And also just the inspiration, for like my nieces to see this really rad female leader on screen. So I totally fell in love. I fell in love with her. I fell in love with this world. I'm a total David versus Goliath, you know, working class kind of girl who just loves those stories and gravitates towards those stories. So I think, you know, for me, I wanted to make sure that these characters felt real and relatable in a world that we know well, just like in our everyday, but these circumstances, these sort of extraordinary circumstances that they're into, that we just relate to them. And I think one of the joys and gifts was coming up with this cast. Like this cast is just the most delightful, kind-hearted, compassionate, wildly talented group of actors you can bring together. And I think that's something that you're going to see throughout the whole season is just these bonds that I think when Jeff and our whole like producer team, we were putting the pieces together early on, you would just see the beautiful chemistry like in the audition process, and you could see the seeds of friendships that would translate so beautifully to the screen. So what, you know, you're initially thinking, oh, how are we going to bring together this cast and all of these really wonderful characters, but it just felt so organic through the whole process. And I think, Jeff, I don't want to speak for you, but I think one thing that I'm so proud of to bring to the screen are these amazing actors and the joy that they are to the screen. I don't know if that answered your question. I'm sorry, I just get excited to see them all. I'm like, I haven't seen them in like 7 months. I get to like, I'm like, I just want to hug them all through the screen.
I want to get into these characters because this is really a character-driven drama at its heart. Let's start with Stella. Tell us about Sarah. What drives her to make these choices for her community that are so brave and so scary at the same time?
Sarah she's lived in Greylock her whole life. It's her home, it's her community, it's her people. She's so deeply tied to her community. And I think part of that comes from the fact that she has a very, very complicated relationship with her immediate family. And so the friendships that she's built in Greylock that's become her family. And I think the idea of that being threatened is sort of like world ending for Sarah and for the other characters in Greylock. And I think she has this little part of her that she's maybe like a little scared of, but she feels like, you know, if we don't stop this from happening, then it's gonna happen. And that means it's in our hands. And so, you know, and we see in the pilot, it's, they're just like, as a team, the group of friends scratching around for any idea to save the town and stop this from happening. And through that process, Sarah sort of ends up in charge of everything. And then we watch her through the season deal with that responsibility and what that means.
Yeah, and that is a big, big responsibility. And it also means she has to go up against her brother, who they're kind of estranged. They have not spoken in a long time, but Danny's back in town and he's working for Leiden and he's kind of up to no good, but we kind of see his relationship with Greylock is a little complicated as well, because of that family dynamic that you mentioned. And he kind of shows up with all this swagger, like, you all just won the lottery for sitting on top of this like plot of land that they love. How will we see him struggle and evolve this season, Luke?
Ooh, that's an interesting question. You will see him. You will most definitely see him struggle and evolve through the course of the season. Danny has quite the path in front of him, but you know, initially, he's come to Greylock to prove himself. I think, you know, I think he needs to prove himself to himself. He needs to prove himself to his bosses. And I think he wants to prove himself desperately to a town that he feels neglected him or rejected him. Maybe not en masse, but there are certainly some individuals there that he might harbor some ill feelings towards. So, you know, I think initially he's just there to do a job. He just wants to do the best job he can. He takes that very seriously. I don't think he intends to necessarily stick around all that long, but that quickly changes. And then that presents a few challenges because the longer he's in town, the more he is forced to face his past. And there are more than his fair share of demons in this town. So yeah.
Yes, he's got a lot going on. And Stella and Luke, how would you describe the dynamic between this brother and sister?
Very fraught. Rough.
Very, very fraught.
Very fraught.
There's
a lot of heartbreak. There's been so much heartbreak.
So much heartbreak. I mean, they're estranged, you know, initially. So there isn't a relationship there. Like, you know, technically they're brother and sister, but they could be strangers, really. And then it's really interesting to see that they're forced into this sort of business relationship initially. And then it's through the business relationship that the personal stuff keeps coming up and they're forced to deal with that. And whether that brings them closer together or pushes them further apart remains to be seen.
Yeah, awesome. Now I want to talk about Stella's crew. We've got Corinne, AJ, and Grover, who are just like the best friends that I think a girl could ask for.
The best friends in the world.
Yeah.
Best friends any character, any human has ever had.
Beyond supportive of any wild.
Beyond.
Yeah. Yeah, it's awesome. Ian, let's start with Grover. What can you say about what Grover is facing this season when the show pretty much begins?
Grover's dealing with, he's dealing with grief.
Yeah.
And he's dealing with a huge void in his life, which he hasn't quite gotten a handle on. But the thing about Grover is that he likes to, he is a supporter, and he's a supporter of his friends. And Sarah, having going through this new process of her, in her life, he wants to be of service to her. And he neglects his feelings and neglects his situation through that because he's such a giver. And I think throughout the season, we're gonna see how that takes a toll on him. How that affects him.
Yeah, definitely. And there are to take a more lighthearted tone, because his story is very heartbreaking as well. There are some sparks between Sarah and Grover going on. Like, there's a little something.
A little something, something. I mean, yeah, they're best friends. They're attracted to each other. They have a long history. They play this. They teeter along this platonic, you know, line. There's a lot of love there. Would you say, Stella?
Yes, I would. I think Sarah has been in love for a long time, but I don't know, maybe not.
I know, I'm like looking down at Jeff when you said that.
Yeah. Oh, sorry, Jeff. No, I mean, like, even just in the pilot, like, I think it's like Grover's the one for Sarah, she thinks, you know?
They definitely have a beautiful friendship that we've seen so far. So it's a really great relationship. And now we also have Nia, AJ is in law enforcement, which like could not be like a less handy gig for someone in this crew to have.
Exactly.
Yeah, like just immediate power player on like that level alone. She also has her own personal issues going on that I think is kind of a slower burn this season, but can you tease anything about what's going on with AJ?
Yeah, I think that's probably my favorite part of AJ, and I think with the viewers too, is you get this little peek inside of, this intimate peek inside of her life, and you get the surprise where it's like, oh, I had no idea this is what she was dealing with, or this is who she is. So yeah, I think when you find out what it is, I think it'll be heartbreaking for some and inspiring for others, and a strength giver for others. But I think that's probably my favorite part about AJ, is you get this part of her where she's, like you said, she's a cop and she's down to help. She knows what to do. She's all about, she has a heart for the people. And you know, she's also that, she has a little bit of sting where, you know, she's not afraid to tell you what you need to hear, but she's always ready to listen, you know, with an open heart and open arms. But I think that's the fun part of AJ too, is you get this surface level, but when you get a bit deeper, it's like, wow. You know, so I think that's my favorite part about AJ as well.
Yeah, she's definitely awesome. And she makes some big sacrifices right off the bat for all of this.
Like, well, all of them do. Like she said, she has some of the best friends you could have.
Yeah, the fact that they still hang out with her. Like, I will be watching to see if by like episode 7, they're all still cool, but you know, it's for really now, they're great. Yeah. Right now, everything's now I want to talk about Hope, obviously. I want to talk about Corinne, obviously. Sorry.
That's fine.
Corinne is just Sarah's like ride or die. They're just total besties. They clearly have a long history together. And she's like a bit of a badass in her own right, from what I see. So can you tell us about her role in Greylock's independence and what it means for her specifically?
Ooh. That's a good question. That's a really good question. Wow, Corinne's role in independence is really, I mean, like she's Sarah's best friend, and I feel like her main role in independence is just kind of being like Sarah's ride or die, Sarah's sounding board. Like, you know, she's not really, you know, super influential in making these big decisions, but she's always there to like, she's kind of like the heart, where like Sarah's maybe the brain, and like Sarah's always there to like sort of talk through things, and Corinne is there to sort of reflect them back to her and talk through different choices and kind of come at them from like an emotional point of view, or like just like keep her grounded and remind her why she even started doing this in the first place, that she started doing it to like fight for this community of people that she loves. Kind of Corinne's role when it comes to creating the country.
Everyone needs that. Everyone needs that. That's great. Yeah. And there's a history, I won't dive too deep into it, but there's a history between Corinne and Danny that we're going they play out. Can you guys tease that a little bit?
Can we tease that a little bit? Luke, you want to tease that?
Sure. Yeah, I'll take that. Yes, there's definitely some sort of history between Danny and Corinne that will will be played out slowly but surely over the course of the season. I don't know how much we can go into it, but there's a lot of heartbreak. There's a lot of heartbreak and unresolved feelings that need to be explored and hopefully healed. Corinne still being in Greylock is going to be incredibly difficult for Danny to continue to be in Greylock. Let's just say that. for Danny to continue to do his job and to maintain the facade that he's strictly here for business.
It's a very juicy storyline. It's got all the juice. It's got heartbreak and juice.
That should be the tagline.
Heartbreak and juice.
That's the name of their album. When they put an album out together, it's heartbreak and juice.
Yep, that's perfect.
He brings the heartbreak, I bring the juice. Sorry, go.
Oh, you're great. Now, there are some other folks in the show that are not present on the Zoom, unfortunately, but they kind of make up this family and political drama that we're going to see, one of which is Megan Follows. Danny and Sarah's mom. It is such a great role. She's a former politician, best-selling author, and as we learned very quickly on, she's an alcoholic. Stella and Luke, how does Megan's character come into play in terms of the family drama aspect of The Republic of Sarah?
Stella.
Okay, fine. No, she's, it's, oh, I mean, how much can I say? Well, okay, so Sarah, you know, it's very complicated, the family situation. And she's lost her brother. She's lost her brother for a long time. And the only person who's been in her life is her mother. And her mother is a very, very troubled person who, has a lot of demons, and Sarah has had to, I mean, I think part of the reason why Sarah is such a, like, has such an impulse to take care of people and to protect the people around her is because she's sort of grown up having to take care of her mother. And that's like a huge responsibility in Sarah's life. And at the same time, Ellen Cooper, Sarah's mother, Megan's character, is incredibly brilliant and has a lot of wisdom and sage advice for Sarah through this process. So it's this like very complicated balance between, you know, this is this person who's been caused a lot of damage and a lot of hurt and who I've had to take care of. And also this person actually has a lot of wisdom when it comes to this like new thing that I'm taking on. It's a good character. It's great.
Definitely a great character. Luke, do you have anything to add?
I would just say that Ellen, Danny and Sarah's mom, is a character that Danny would very much like to not exist, or certainly not exist in Greylock. They have zero relationship, and I'm not sure that they will. I don't know. They have a very complicated relationship or non-relationship, or there's a deep dark history there that we will explore. As much as I was saying before, that Corinne's presence in Greylock makes it difficult for Danny to move forwards, Ellen's presence in Greylock makes it infinitely worse, because she is his demons. She is the demon that he's facing and the thing that he needs to heal from, basically. So
definitely. No, that was very well said. We also have Stella students who we get to meet throughout these first couple episodes. We have Forrest Goodluck, Landry Bender, I don't know if I'm saying that right, I hope I am, and Isabella Alvarez, who are so inspired by Stella's teachings that they go out and kind of do their own thing, which is really cool to see. Jeffrey, can you speak a bit about how the younger generation affects the action in the show?
Yeah, I think, you know, we're living in this era right now, and thank God that we are, where there's real empowerment among young people and really young people. I mean, the Greta Thunbergs and the Malalas and the kids from Stoneman Douglas. And like, you know, there's a teenage generation now that when they see a wrong, they want to right it, and they are driven to do that, and they're motivated to do that. And that's inspiring to me as an old man, you know? So in thinking about the sort of wish fulfillment and the inspiration of this story and how you would build a country, like having three teenagers who see the world in different ways, but want to make the world better and want to have an impact. Allowing that voice to shine in this show too is really important, was really important to me. I was a teacher, I taught for a year before I moved to Los Angeles. And kids are incredible because there's a fearlessness to being teenage. I'm sure we all remember. There's a bravery to being a teenager where the word no doesn't really exist. You know, the question I think that rings in teenagers' heads always is why not? And so that inspiration, and there are some moments in the show where they really save the adult characters. They are there for the adults when the adults need somebody to say, why not? We can do this. Don't give up. So they were vital to the story. They're awesome. Those three actors are incredible. And they begin to form sort of big brother, big sister relationships with a lot of the cast that's here today. And that's really exciting. And they have conflict and drama of their own. And they also provide us a fun lens to just also explore like fun teenage storylines that don't have as much to do with country building. Just, you know, falling in love for the first time and having sex for the first time and, you know, friendships and moving to a new place and all that stuff, which is also just rich character drama. So they're great. And I'm really glad that they have become as big a part of the show as they have been.
Yeah, definitely. It helps too as like a CW drama, because like this is a very serious show covering a lot of very serious issues. Having that teenage lens kind of helps a little bit, I think. It's nice.
Yeah, I think it does. I think they also like the show. I mean, you know, we've been talking a lot about heartache in the last 10 minutes, and there is a lot of heartache in the show. And I think for me, that just comes from like, you know, like a lot of my closest friends, like this idea that every family in the world is this perfect white picket fence is just not true. You know, all of my closest friends have been through some hard things, and there's a strength that is born of going through trauma. So all five of the characters that are here today, like they have been through some stuff, but it's all grounded in reality. And it's based on experiences with the writer's room that we all shared with each other. And for me as a writer, like, and as a creator, that trauma, and that, like I said, it sort of builds a spine in characters for me. There's a strength that is born often of trauma. I know that from trauma in my own life and trauma in my friends' lives. But also there's a lot of fun in the show, and the teenagers particularly just provide that. Like, I think whenever we start to get a little serious about stuff, which is fun and exciting in its own right, but like there is this kind of bubbliness that comes from the teenagers, and, you know, just again reminding us about like the funnier side of this whole situation of like, you're starting a country, like this is ridiculous. Like, it's both absurd, you know, but also somewhat realistic. So I think there is a fun, there's two sides to this coin, and the teenage energy and sort of youthfulness allows us to keep ourselves having lots of fun. But I will say for whatever it's worth, that like the joy of these five characters here too is that, like, I'd like to think, not to toot my own horn, but I think they all have different sides to them, and they all, you know, are kind of fun, and there's a lot of lightness in the show from them too. It's not just that the teenagers are bubbly, like all five of our main characters as well. I think the joy of them and why these actors play them so well is that they have really serious sides. They've been through some dark stuff, but they also are a lot of fun. And they prank each other and they play games and they fall in love. And so I think that's what makes the series as compelling as it is that there is a lot of light and dark. It's always kind of light and dark married together.
Definitely. Now, there's on-screen pranking. Was there off-screen pranking as well?
Oh yes, Luke started a war.
Oh my gosh. Oh boy, did he.
Started a war, come
he
on.
He started a war. So, you know, as you know, there was snow everywhere on set. And I don't even know how it started. No, this is the narrative and it's all gone off the rails. What happened was, he was walking around, Luke, you were walking around with a snowball, and we were like, what are you, threatening us? And you were like, maybe. And then we were like, well, let's get him after we wrap this scene so, okay, before he can get us.
That was a cute little fictional story. Would you like the truth? The truth of the matter is that we were filming a scene outdoors, lots of snow, and I was being a little cheeky and making snowballs. And Hope happened to notice and was like, what are you going to do with that? I was like, I don't know, I'm just making snowballs.
Just makes snowballs. Right, being cheeky making snowballs.
Hang on, I'm not finished. Then I was like, all right, I'm going to throw one in her direction, but not at her because she's in hair and makeup and wardrobe. So I'm just going to friendly fire. And that's how it started. It was like one snowball in her direction. And then after that, I think it was these three young ladies all ganged up on me after the scene and actually got me in the face with multiple snowballs. And
right then, in the face.
From then on, it was on.
Did the first snowball make contact though?
Mine or theirs?
Yours.
No. Friendly.
Emily, that's all semantics, okay? He had the snowballs. He was throwing them around in directions. Come on.
Yeah.
And then I think I went up to Nia and Stella and I was like, listen, ladies.
She came to my trailer in a very deep breath, breathing very hard, having been chased by Luke, and she was, you know, asking me to join her team. I didn't pick sides. The cast was almost torn apart because of this. So
to get back to the show, there are some hurdles that Sarah is facing right off the bat and the town has to deal with right away. It's pretty much immediate, like, emergency mode for these guys. I think it's safe to say that the governor poses like the biggest upcoming threat to Greylock, but could you tease a little bit, a few of the big like impending moments that we have for this town now that they have declared independence?
Oh, I mean, it's episode after episode is just dodging disaster. Every single one, it's endless. It's an endless stream of disasters that they have to deal with. The first one, and sort of she carries on through the season, is the governor of New Hampshire. I mean, it's a town of 2,700 people, and it's, you know, billions of dollars worth of resources. And the governor wants it desperately. And kind of understand why, you know, but also like at what cost? And so, yeah, negotiating with the governor is the first main obstacle, and she has all the tools, you know, she has all the resources to take us out. And so the ways that we as a group figure out how to survive that is sort of the first few episodes.
Yeah, there's a lot of strategy involved and just basically putting out metaphorical fires. I will say metaphorical, even though, you know, there might be a literal fire. I don't know if I'm allowed to say that. I want to talk about the focus of the show on normal people doing extraordinary things. I just love this as a concept. It is just so invigorating and inspiring after the year that we've all been through. And it just feels really great to see that on screen. How do we see that kind of like almost motto, it feels like, for the show kind of affect each of these characters who are normal people, more or less?
I would say I think the most change happens in real life the way it happens in the show, which is inside your community with the people that you spend day-to-day life with, because you all are dealing with the same issues. And I think that when you see the show, it's easier to look at it on a less grand scale, which is and more on a smaller scale, which is like, this is the town that they love. You know, they live here, this is their home. And I think that it all starts there, and that's what you see here in the show. And I think it's just a beautiful example of what happens when you take charge of your community, when you are the change that you want to see for yourself. You know, I don't think the show is about this is the way to do it, but I think it's a beautiful way. You know, Jeff did a beautiful job of seeing what it's like, where it's like, wow, what if we did it this way? And then you get to see all of those intricate relationships within that. So it's a powerful thing. And I think most change happens the way you see it happen in the show.
I think to Mia's point, our characters are faced with such giant decisions to make and such giant like shoes to fill and roles to fill as the country keeps getting developed. And I think that what's interesting is, I know for Corinne, she has a tendency to underestimate herself. And then she's faced with moments where she has the option to step into a powerful role and she feels sort of maybe unworthy or just not prepared. And I think it's just so each of these characters go through something like that. We get to watch them faced with their own, you know, coming up against their own like ideas of what their abilities are. And then you get to watch them like grow past what they thought they could ever do because of being put in the situation of like, we are a new country. Does that make sense?
Oh, it does.
Okay, good.
What's really cool about each character is that they all have strengths that throughout the season it really highlights each of their strengths in terms of how they played their part in building this country. It's a family, and I think we did a pretty good job.
I think we did okay.
I will say I love the sort of wrapping of it all. Is everything comes from a place of compassion and kindness, and it feels so necessary and just needed right now. And I think Jeff and the writing team and all of these guys, like everything comes from a place of compassion, and that is something I just love so much about this show.
Yeah, I just want to say, I think it's also, you know, coming from a community teamwork angle, you know, these people, seeing these characters grow and overcome these obstacles, they're not just doing it by themselves because they're all flawed and they need help. And so there are other characters in this world that have the right key to help them unlock that next stage of growth. And I think that's part of the really beautiful thing about our show.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's like, it's about building a country, but it's also just like about these people growing up and the idea that, like you said, Emily, like ordinary people can do extraordinary things. It's kind of like everyone's ordinary until you just try to do a thing. Mm-hmm. You just try to do a thing that's not been done before and you just fucking work, sorry. you just really try to do the extraordinary thing and then you've done it. You know, you've tried it. And that's really what the show is. It's not about being extraordinary. It's about just standing by something and fighting for it. And anyone can do that. And anyone who is extraordinary is just a person who's done that.
I'll tack on that as well, which is like, ideally too, that the show I think reminds our viewers, especially in America, that like, we all live in a country that was started by ordinary people. You know, like in the pilot, there's a reference to a group of revolutionary soldiers called the Green Mountain Boys who were in Vermont. And like, even this country, yes, it's America, was founded by a bunch of ordinary farmers who decided like, we can do better. And so they tried and they did. So it's just nice to remind people like, be your own hero. You know, like if you want to change something, then change it. You know, like that's it. George Washington didn't start out as George Washington, you know, like to Stella's point. So we're aware of the history of our own country in sort of making this and crafting this, and there are echoes of that here too.
Yeah, absolutely. And kind of building on that, I love that there's like a punk rock aesthetic and vibe, and you get the music, you get Stella's awesome leather jacket that you get to wear as Sarah that I want to steal that jacket already. Like it is so cool. And Kat, you kind of mentioned this a little bit in the beginning, the punk rock aesthetic. It does kind of feed into this idea of like this revolution and this building upon something and just all of these like really great, cool ideas that these characters come up with as they're forming a country. How would you say Jeff, Kat, anybody else who wants to answer, how would you say that the punk leads to all of the rest of this craziness? Because they are kind of all punk rockers in their own weird superhero way.
Yeah, Kat, you've had so much to do with the aesthetic of that as the director of the pilot, so I'll let her handle it.
Oh, gosh, I thought you were going to take it. What these characters are doing is punk rock. They're taking ownership. They're, you know, taking the reins and like fighting for what they love and what is so meaningful to them. But on an aesthetic level, I mean, so a lot of the early conversations between Jeff and I were, you know, music, the style, the look. Like when I talk to people, things that I love to do, it's like punk rock, heavy metal, blue collar, working class. And so this was my jam. And it was fun, like just discovering new bands that we were excited to put into the show. There was like a mandate of like trying to find bands that may not be able to discover otherwise on the radio or whatnot. And here's our secret ingredient to put in really rad, young, undiscovered talent in the music as well. And you know, working with our costume designer on the look of all of these guys was super fun. You know, I think thrift stores and that kind of appeal and like flawed, frayed aesthetic to a lot of this that just, again, feels everyday and feels normal and feels lived in, which is what, again, I hope translates on the screen for all of us.
Yeah. And I think like, if I like on the story side of it, like the, I grew up that way, you know, like I grew up as a bit of a skate kid, punk rocker, like, and I just, the glossy never appealed to me. You know, I think the most beautiful people in the world are the people that are in mosh pits, you know, like people who are themselves and are unafraid to be sweaty and are unafraid to be imperfect. You know, imperfect is perfect. That's kind of the idea of the show. And so like, there's this kind of rebellious spirit in the world of punk rock. That always spoke to me and that felt right here and also just felt like something I would like to watch on TV. You know, TV, as we all know, can sometimes be very glossy and very perfect. And like, it's hard for viewers, I think, sometimes to see themselves in that when like everybody's in 7-inch stilettos and looking perfect. And like, I think for me, like our characters are real people, man. You know, like they wear the same winter coat all winter. You know, we don't all have 12 winter coats. Like they just feel like real people. And then just because the music, to what Kat was saying too, the music thing, like the music on our show is awesome. I mean, just a couple of anecdotes where we had like our music supervisors sometimes would call record labels to get the rights to certain bands, and the record labels thought we were joking. They were like, I'm sorry, the CW wants to put a Silvermount Zion on? Like, is this a joke? I don't understand. Like we have music on the show that has never been on ever TV. We had a couple of bands write music for us, like alternate versions of existing songs that don't exist yet, but they did it for us because they liked the show so much and they thought the spirit was really cool. So that punk rock thing is sort of permeates every element of the show and has lent itself to a pretty badass soundtrack, I would say.
Definitely. No, that's awesome. I love that. It's just like another extra awesome layer to the show, which is really cool. I think we only have a few more minutes left. I would love for each of the cast members, I know you guys teased so much already. If you want to tease in like 1 to 5 words, let's say, I'll make it easy. One thing that's coming up for your character that you're really excited for viewers to see this season. Who wants to start us off? I know you're all so scared. It was a scary question. You know, it looks like you might know what you want to say.
You got, Nate? What you got?
Come on. It's fun, say, just like watching them.
I would say, just from them seeing the first 2 episodes, I would say, who is that woman?
Yes.
Who is that woman she's with? I would say that.
Nia, that's so good.
I was relinquishing and purging for Grover.
Exploring fantasy. take from that what you will.
Come on home.
Stepping into her power. That's not great. The other thing I was gonna say was juice, but we already went there. Enough of that. Stella?
Oh, just so many mistakes.
That's good.
Yeah, running your own country. That's pretty much, that was a good way to bring it home. That was good. Awesome. Well, thank you guys so much for joining me today. Thank you everyone out there for watching in the audience. Everyone go watch The Republic of Sarah. It airs 9/8 Central on the CW on Monday nights. It's awesome, obviously. These guys are great. Follow ATX Festival on social media and hashtag TV for all. And everyone go enjoy the rest of ATX Festival season 10.
Woo!
Yeah. Thanks, Emily.
Thank you, Emily.
Thank you so much, Emily.